Today is a story about my mental breakdown. You ready for this? Like to hear it, here go. Hey, you're all Supa Duper Chris here. Thank you for joining me on All These Things TV. If this is your first time, welcome. And if it's not, hey girl, it's good to see you again. Here at All These Things TV, I make content geared for the millennial mother and wife to help her live her most fulfilled and inspired life while having a relationship with God. So if that's something that you're interested in, please be sure to hit the subscribe button down below. I'd really appreciate it. So today we are talking about, I'm really taking this time to share my story about my breakdown for a few reasons. So the first reason is that during this story that I'm going to share with you, it really shed a light on how the whole issue of mental awareness and mental health is overlooked and not taken seriously. Like, when I get into this story, y'all are gonna be like, really? This really happened to you? And it's just like, it's almost like when they came out with like affirmative action, it's like, yes, we're all about equality, but we just want one token black person, or we just want one token gay person. You know what I'm talking about? That's kind of how I feel about mental wellness, in sense of, oh yes, we care about your mental space, work-life balance. But then when the rubber hits the road and breakdowns are actively happening, it's just like, you know, this is what you can do, this is what you can do. And there's no real action that is taken for to really fix or aid or help people in the situations that they have during the actual breakdown or the panic attack. So I want to share my story because I'm also going to open a part of my channel to be a platform for women like me who deal with mental illness, I guess, deal with mental challenges in terms of their wellness, and create a space to let you guys know that I'm here, I'm going through it with you. I want to share resources, I want to share advice, and I want us to get through this together. I have named myself an advocate for not only mental health awareness, but CBD, because CBD has helped me so much with my mental wellness and able to calm me and relax me and help me to gather my thoughts. But that's gonna be another video. That's gonna be the video right after this one. So stay tuned for that one, because that one is done, but I didn't wanna just throw y'all into what I was passionate about without kind of giving you an intro and explaining why I feel the way that I feel and why I'm taking the route that I'm taking. On what day was that? I think it was like July 2nd. On July 2nd, I had what people like to call, I don't even know if it's medically diagnosed, but I had what people like to call a mental breakdown. I want to take it back a little bit. For about 3 months prior to this happening, I had noticed that I was becoming a little desensitized to people's stories of triumph with mental wellness. I've always battled with mental wellness. In college and high school, I had panic attacks. I was diagnosed with anxiety. I was diagnosed with depression. The semester before my last semester, I was taking depression medicines because I was just sad all the time. I wanted to be by myself, and I just wanted to just watch movies and cry. Like, I enjoyed crying, and I just was sad all the time, but I would try and pull myself out of it, and then when I try, it come right back. And it was a real battle with depression, and I ended up getting on medicine for it. Eventually got off, dealt with a little postpartum, had a suicide situation with postpartum, to where I planned out my suicide in my head. And then I was able to be like, whoa, this is scary. And I called my family, and they surrounded themselves around me, and everything was fine. That was back in 2017 when that happened, like right when Eden was born. Fast forward into the end of 2018, November, December. No, it was more like the beginning of this year. It was like January, March, around that time. And I was like, man, I think I need to see somebody. And I was just feeling really sad, feeling really invaluable, feeling like I didn't have any value, feeling like I didn't matter. And I just kind of brushed it off and was like, no, but I'm doing this. You know, just trying to psych yourself up. And I would say things to my husband or my friends and be like, you know what? I have these thoughts going on. I really didn't go into detail about it. I would just be like, you know, I have these thoughts going on and I think it's a good idea for me to go and see somebody. But I never got around to it. I started a business this year and I've been going. We're moving to this new place. We're trying to get everything together so we can officially purchase it. And you know, we just been going through a lot. So I was like, I'm gonna have to put that on the back burner. We got too much to do. I gotta hustle it out. Bad idea. I don't even know so I'm just gonna talk about the actual day and talk about my trigger points. The night before, Fago and I had gotten into this really long, huge argument. And we were up till like 2 a.m. Not even an argument, just kind of a back and forth and trying to come to a compromise on things. And I ended up feeling like everything was my fault. Not from him telling me that everything was my fault. I just internalized everything. Like I'm the reason why we aren't, me and Abel aren't on the same page. And just internalizing everything. And then I woke up. And because we had gone to sleep so late, we woke up late, so we were a little bit behind. I was like 30 minutes behind, so I knew I was gonna be late for work. So we're rushing and I'm trying to get the kids to daycare because they have a breakfast cutoff. And I will give them fruits and stuff and like breakfast bread and stuff here in the morning to kind of get them to daycare so they can have a full on breakfast. But I was trying to get there before the breakfast cut off because if you're not there and you ain't gonna eat, you know. But I was rushing and Cadence was like, come on, Dad. And she was fussing at Fago because I have to drop him off, then drop them off, then go to work. Cadence is upset and Fago leaves and he usually kisses and tells everybody bye and that he loves them. And he was like, bye, Cadence. She was like, bye. I was like, bye, babe. And I said bye to him. He went on. I said, Cadence, what is wrong with you? She said, Daddy is just so slow. I'm so irritated with it. So then that hurt me. I internalized it again because there are times where Fago is a grandpa, y'all. Fago moves very slow. He moves very intentionally. So and I, with my anxiety, I'm always frazzled and moving really quick. And then like, I forget this. So I'm everywhere. And he's like the yin to my yang. He'd be like, okay, got this. Okay. Let's do this. Okay, let's go. Okay. Like he moves real slow and it irks me. So I'm like, oh my God, she's upset. She's feeling this way because she's seen me be upset with him for moving so slow. So I get upset and I start crying. And then all of a sudden the whole world seemed to cave in on me. And it was like, I can't do anything right. I'm a terrible mom. I'm being a terrible example for my kids. My business isn't taking off. We need money. I don't know how we're gonna get groceries. Everything that has to do with me has just gone to waste. I'm not valuable. Nothing I do is worth anything. I started to contemplate running my car into the back of semis or running my car off the side of the guardrail. And my thoughts started to scare me. So we have a family chat on Facebook, all my siblings and my parents and I. And I said, and my husband said, guys, I'm having some suicidal thoughts. Send some prayers. I think I'm gonna go to the hospital. And I was on my way to work, so I called my boss and I was like, hey, upset, emotional, crying. I'm not doing well. I'm not mentally well. At least I had enough sense at this point to be like, I'm not well. Instead of relishing in these thoughts and actually doing something, I need to find a hospital. So, in between stoplights, I'm looking at hospitals. I looked up the suicide line. I called my boss and was like, I'm not well. I'm gonna go to the hospital. I'm sorry, I hope you understand. And I hung up. So then I called the suicide line, hoping that I could get some help. I called the suicide line and they put me on hold. You know, the suicide hotline, that old dude sang in the song. I called it and they put me on hold. I was on hold for about 4 or 5 minutes. I don't know why I stayed on hold for that long. I was on hold. The suicide hotline had me on hold. So that was the first indicator, like, oh my God, do they really care? Do they really care? Is there not enough help? What is it? This is after I had gone through everything and just replaying the situation in my mind. Like, do they need more volunteers? Do they need more money? Why am I on hold when I'm considering killing myself? Why am I on hold? There's nobody that can talk to me right now. I'm driving, considering running into the back of a semi. I'm driving, considering running off the side of a guardrail. And I call the help that everybody says to reach out to when you're in this crisis, and I'm on hold for 4 minutes. I hung up. Either way, hey, we have to do something about this. This is one reason why I am now an advocate. Connect me with who I need to connect with so that I can help. Because I would be devastated if somebody I love called the hotline and got on hold and decided nobody really cares, not even the suicide hotline cares about me. I would hate that. Please direct me to who I need to talk to so that I can help. Please. Anyway, so I get off the phone and I go to a park. I turn my phone off. I'm like, these niggas don't care. They don't care about what I got going on. The suicide hotline don't care. My boss don't care. My family don't care. Nobody cares. I'm shutting all my shit off and I am going to the park. And this is when I feel like the breakdown really, really happened. So I've been going to therapy for about a month now. And there was a conversation that I had with my therapist about how it's the amygdala. I think it's the part of your brain, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong. I didn't really research it, but it's a part of your brain that shares your emotions. And if you have anxiety, it's the part of your brain that makes you go, oh my God, oh, I'm having a panic. It's that part of your brain. And when that part of your brain is so live and so wired, it can shut down your prefrontal cortex, which is the part of your brain that tells you to calm down. The part of your brain that tells you, oh, that's an irrational thought. And what happened to me is that when I was at the park, the part of my brain that tells me that's a silly idea left. You know how, I hope I don't sound crazy, but you know, you can have a thought that's like, oh, we're like really negative and really off the wall, and then you can usually like pull yourself out of like, girl, that's crazy talk. You know, you can fix this. Now you can get, you know, you got it. That you got it voice was gone, silent. So anything that was irrational, anything that didn't make sense was perfect, made perfect sense to me. They don't love me. They don't care. If they cared about me, they would know where I am, even though I shut my phone off and I was sitting at the park by myself and didn't tell nobody. If they don't find me, I'm just gonna sit here until somebody does. And I sat at the park crying, thinking irrational thoughts uncontrollably because I couldn't pull myself out of this spiral that I was going through for about 3 hours. And I wanted my family and my friends to think I was dead. I wanted them to, in my mind, I was like, if I make them think that I'm dead, maybe they'll care more about me. If they think that I've died, maybe then they'll listen to me when I say I need help. If maybe I pretended that I died, they would really see how valuable I think I am, or how valuable I think they should think I am. And it was bad. So eventually, it was hot. It's July, so I was thirsty. I went and got a pack of cigarettes and a beer. And went home. And as soon as I went home, there were about 6 cars in my driveway. What happened? I think I came back to my back porch and lit a cigarette and got some water, and everybody was just sitting in here quiet. And I smoked, I hit the cigarette a couple of times, put it out, and threw my glass, shattered it. Came inside and went off on everybody. Like, how the you niggas finna act like I care now? Now that you think I'm dead. But now that I'm alive, y'all can go get out of my house, because obviously you didn't care when I was alive. So why would you all of a sudden act like you care now that you think I'm dead? Like, why does that matter? I went off for about an hour. I went off on Faygo about 4 times. They took the keys from me, so I couldn't run away anymore. Because they didn't want me to run away anymore because they didn't know where I was. And I came back, thank God. So I ran away. They took the keys when I came home. And they tried to get me to stay at home. Excuse me. And I said, no, I left on foot in my breakdown moment, left on foot and walked to another park, which is maybe two blocks away. And I sat there for about an hour, disappeared again. Didn't even bring my phone this time. Just brought, I poured my beer in a mason jar and walked the streets with this beer to the park. Nobody bothered me, surprisingly, by the grace of God. Nobody bothered me, because, you know, that's illegal. I get to the park, and this is when I really felt that the part of my brain that helps me rationalize was gone, because I was sitting on the bench and I was moving like I was talking to somebody, but my mouth wasn't moving. So I'm sitting there on the bench like going off with no words. So then I finally came back home and took a shower and went off again. Took a shower. And by this time I come home and Fago is curled up on the couch crying. Nobody knows what's going on with me and I don't give a fuck. So I get in the shower and then I get out and I light me another cigarette and I turn on, I think I turned on Jay Money or something. I think I turned on Jay Money, he's a Christian rap artist. And I listened to him and everybody kind of just sat there and let me watch the YouTube channels. And then I started to talk. And it was like, as soon as I took my shower and sat there and listened to some good word in music and just kind of breathed through it, I wasn't fully all the way there, but I was there enough to be like, okay, now you can kind of look at what just happened to you. You just went off on your family. Like, you cussed them niggas out. And you broke two glasses in your house. You came home and left again on foot. And I know it's still a lot for you, but this is happening. This is me in my head now. So the voice was trying to come back. The voice of reason was trying to come back at this point. So I sat there and I put everything on pause and I said, I'm sorry, y'all. I have been talking to a couple of you guys, and said a while ago that I felt like I needed some help, and I don't know what happened. I couldn't explain it. So they asked how we could be there. They went and got my kids. So they asked me to go to the hospital. And this is another reason why I'm an advocate. This upset me as well. They were like, there's emergency rooms that you can go to for mental health. So I went to a local mental health emergency room. And I said, I had suicidal thoughts today. I ran away a couple of times. And I'm just trying to see what can be done for me. So I waited for about 4 hours for them to do one test for me, to tell me to send me with some resources. They gave me two options: to be locked away for about 2 weeks with little to no contact with my family for mental evaluation, or to go home and look at resources. They had me in this padlocked bed. Thankfully, all my family was there. I felt like I had an incurable contagious disease going to the emergency room with mental illness. And I don't understand how someone who is considering taking their lives gets treated as if they have a contagious, unknown, incurable disease, instead of being treated with care and love and softness. Because when you go through a breakdown, my mother-in-law told me this and I resonated with it so well. When you go through a mental breakdown, it's not just a one time, you snap and then you come back. It's like you snap and then you're fizzling and you just have all these live wires on edge. Your nerves are on edge. So somebody could just speak too loud and you snap again. I told my family I didn't want them to treat me like a baby, but I wanted them to still care. Even though I'm up and I'm talking and I'm moving, this is not something that is just fly by night. because I had those live end wires, and there was a situation where I wanted to see my kids, but they didn't want me to see my kids because I was still sensitive. It was like the day after or something. And I was like, I need to see him. And I was just snapping. I wasn't making sense. I was yelling. Like one day, one second, I was cool. And then the next second, I was going off on people at the barbecue spot because I thought they was talking to me. I was ready to knuck if you buck just because I was on nerve endings. And if anybody knows me, I'm not confrontational. I'm not, well, you got something to say. I'm not that person. So for me to go from, yeah, I'm cool, we chilling, for me to be like, are you talking to us? Do you have a problem? Is really crazy for me. The very next day, we end up going to ReDiscover, which is a mental wellness place, and I got an evaluation that actually made sense. And this ReDiscover, I thank you. Thank you, ReDiscover, for opening your doors and treating me like a person that has a mental challenge. Instead of just somebody who's on edge that you need to padlock and put away because they gonna kill themselves. Like, I felt like an animal. And that's why I'm so passionate about how we treat people that say they have a mental concern. You can't say whether somebody's situation is more severe or less severe. You can't say that what someone is dealing with deems the feelings of suicide or not. You cannot diagnose somebody that has a mental. You need the best thing that anybody could have done for me during this time was listen and point me to professionals. Don't try and self-aid. Don't try and go, girl, you just need a glass of wine. Girl, you just need to, no, don't give me your advice. Listen to me, tell me that you care, and direct me to a professional. And I'm sharing this story because it's inspired me to create a space for people that, specifically people like me, women like me, that are strong and push their mental wellness to the side and disregard how they feel because they got too much to do. They got too much going on. And one day, I would hate for it to happen. I don't want anybody that sees my content to just snap. I want to create content that gives you the strength and the resources and the knowledge to pinpoint when you're hurting and to resolve it. And I hope that I can do that, because if I knew there was a space for me to have that, to where I could resonate with it, I would have done it. My camera's about to die, but I love you guys. I hope this story encouraged you. That's it for me today. Please like, comment, and subscribe. Thank you for your love and your prayers, and we'll see you guys next time. Bye.